and welcome to yet another amazing edition of Mixed Rated. I'm your esteemed host, Olivia Speranza.
Ooh. Yeah.
Great.
And I'm your boy, Joey Gill in the house.
All right. Wow, this crowd is deader than Osama. What is going on, you guys?
Oh, too soon.
Yeah, too soon. Sorry. Anyways, wake up, everybody, because we have an awesome episode for you today. Hello.
You know it, because in this episode, Trish Cleung and I head to La La Land to give you an inside look at America's Best Dance Crew Season 6. Season 6.
While you guys are battling it out on the dance floor, I'll be rumbling in the cage with UFC fighter Mark Munoz. Yeah!
And finally, it may be the month of May, but April Chase will be getting undiscovered. Yeah! Seriously, Olivia, that's crazy. It's crazy. A terrorist is gone, and now Caucasians are now dancing in front of the White House with no rhythm. Just, yeah, he's dead. He's dead. It's like having a DJ at a funeral, man.
Yeah, I know, right? And speaking of dancing, some of you may remember my lovely co-host over here releasing an instructional dance DVD called Get Jelly With It.
Get Jelly With It. Did you guys see it? Did you guys see it?
Unfortunately, it was seared into my brain. But I got to say, Joey, there is somebody out there on the interwebs giving you a run for your money.
What you talking about, Olivia?
And you know what? I've got to say, it's pretty catchy. Check it out.
And left foot 8 times. Right foot. Now 4 to the left. 4 to the right. And 2. Double green feet.
That was pretty good, right, Joe? Joey?
I'm right.
Okay, here we go.
Oh, you don't fly. Don't want into this salsa with chips.
Oh my God, no thank you.
Olivia, I should charge you for this.
No thank you, Joey. Well, he's over there doing that. Let's go ahead and check out what's going on this season at America's Best Dance Crew.
What's up, guys? This is Trish.
And I'm Joey Gila, and we are at America's Best Dance Crew Season 6. Trish, tell them what's going on today.
We're going to talk to some of the judges, meet some of the crews, and give you the behind-the-scenes look to America's Best Dance Crew.
Let's do this.
Let's do this.
Yo, I'm here with... name in bed, girl says. I say, skip the egg noodle or the rice noodle. Millions of people just watched you, man. How do you feel when you get off stage? What's the rush like?
Oh, when we get off stage, it's just crazy. Like, when they're cheering for us, it's like, all right, we know they loved it. We know we did our best. And then it's like, all right, we just put what we did out there, and that's all we can do. Now it's just up to the audience to absorb it in and just basically see how they feel about it.
You get a little crump sample, my friend. So what gets you pumped up every day? What's your number one motivation as dancers?
Crump, we have to bring something that has never been brought before. I mean, people have tried to get crump, but it's never been an all authentic crump group. So that keeps us going because we have something different for everybody here.
Went to the barber, got all my faded. Chilling with the Mixed Rated. D-Trix on this microphone. I just ruined your show.
No, that was smooth, brother. So how does it feel? From being on the show, now judging the show, isn't that a trip?
Yeah, it's crazy. I grew up watching all the dancers on stage. I'm fans of all of them, and I'm part of their community. So to be like, you know, representing them behind the judges' table, it's like, I'm still like sitting there like, wow, I can't believe I'm watching
this. All right, what's up, you guys? It's Chris.
And what's up? This is Gently of Poriotics.
And we're here with who?
I am me!
You guys are definitely kind of that crew that I'm like, what are they going to do next time? How are you going to top yourself? Is there something that you guys are kind of like saving that you really, really want to do, but you don't want to do it too early? Or
some things we have already been like, oh, we can use this for this challenge or this part of the song. And sometimes we'll be in practice at the hotel and like, oh, let's make up something new. Or so we're always trying to keep new things coming in and keeping our old stuff in our mind to use whenever.
I'm with
the Iconic Boys.
I need some advice. I want to meet a girl. How's going to impress her?
Well, you got to start with the hair.
The hair. Look at this hair.
You got to start with the hair.
Now you got to go through. What's up?
The shoes.
These aren't like my favorite, but you got to rock my shoes.
I want to dance. She's like, can you teach me one dance move, please? Teach Uncle Joey one move. One quick move. Yeah, here we go. Oh, damn! I'm going to try right now. Ready? Was that okay?
Yeah!
Oh, man, I'm part of the crew?
We're here with who, you guys?
787!
There's B-boy crews always get it, and crews that do stunts get it on this show. They always want you to do more choreography. How are you gonna react to everybody that's kind of saying, oh, they're not dancing? What are you guys gonna show them tonight?
The secret that we have is that we are dancers before trickers, you know? All of us are dance teachers back in Puerto Rico. We're gonna try to pull this off little by little because we want them to see that we are trickers, but now we're gonna give them the dance part. That's what we're gonna bring now.
I'm here with
Bump Phenomenon!
I want to see a dance move you guys do for the ladies when you're at the club.
Ready, be careful, because you might fall in love.
Nobody see it, nobody see it,
nobody see it.
Tell us how the crews did, but do it as Little Mama.
See, what had happened on stage is y'all was on the stage, right? And y'all was dancing because there was music on. And I love the fact that y'all's dancing when the music is on because it's just so right for America's Best Dance Crew. And I respect that. Love is love.
And I appreciate that.
Yeah, keeping it real. Keeping it real. That ain't shuffling, man. That's a running man.
Who are you?
I am me!
Shh!
Ooh, thuggers. Right? Metrosexual thuggers, brother. Oh, crumping! You don't want none. Yo, crazy. America's Best Dance Crew, season 6. Oh, man. Had a fun date with, what's your name again?
Anyway. Thanks to everybody here at ABDC. We had a blast. If you want to stay connected to MTV, please tune in on Thursdays at 10 p.m.
Yes, and by the way she looks, you know it was the best date ever, right?
I guess.
That's cold-blooded. You're getting Olivia all jealous. Don't get...
Honey, there's nothing to be jealous about.
Back to you.
See you later, girl.
That's cold. You're sitting in front of the TV and we're filming. That's me.
Left foot! Times.
Yeah! Work it, girl!
Get it, Joey! Get it! You better pivot that foot! Pivot!
I'm gonna charge food stamps with this thing.
All right, you guys, you don't want to go anywhere because Mark Munoz is coming up next. Mark, you don't want none of this!
Okay, here we go.
See, this is a dandruff, girl. Head and shoulders, head and shoulders. Oh, man, in case you missed it, we were getting our groove on in the last segment. What?
Oh, yeah, that was fun. You know what? Can we just take a look at that one more time, please?
Oh, man. That qualifies us for special parking right there.
Yeah, those were definitely some badass moves right there. And speaking of badasses, I actually stepped into the cage with UFC fighter Mark Munoz.
What, Mark?
Yes, Mark.
That's my boy. That's okay. My boy. No, seriously, he taught me that move, the rear naked choke.
Oh, yeah, I know that one.
Yeah, the rear naked choke. And okay. I taught my girl that, and now she's pregnant.
All right, so says the TMI king yet again. All right, here's Mark and I. Check it out. Hey guys, I'm here at the Undisputed Boxing Gym in San Carlos, California, with none other than UFC fighter, wrestler, and just kind of all-around badass, Mark Munoz. How are you?
I'm great.
Thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
I'm super excited to be interviewing you right now.
Oh, man, I'm super excited to be here.
Tell us a little bit about your nickname here.
I really didn't want a nickname. I kind of wanted to just be Mark Munoz, you know?
Yeah.
But my manager came up with the Philippine Wrecking Machine.
Right.
I was like, man, that has a good ring to it, man. Kind of got some flack for it because the Philippine is kind of like an object, like the Philippine brand mangoes.
Yeah.
You know?
Right, that's what I was thinking. I'm like, wouldn't it be Filipino?
It's Filipino. Yeah. So then it got changed to Filipino Wrecking Machine.
Got
so that's
it.
Why I go by now.
So you didn't give yourself that nickname?
I didn't.
Okay, good, because that's super, like, uncool.
Yeah, I know.
As far as wrestling goes, how did you get into it?
So I started wrestling when I was 13.
Uh-huh.
When I was growing up, I played all the major sports. Some of my friends, they were into wrestling.
So you fell into it. It was sort of like a happy accident.
It was an accident. So I got into it and end up liking it, and you know, and the rest is history from there. So end up being the school's first state champion in any sport.
Really?
And the first national champion in any sport. And then I got a full ride to Oklahoma State. So it actually worked out.
Nice. Of course it did. I mean, come on, look at you now. How did that evolve into MMA?
Went to Oklahoma State, wrestled there for 4 years, coached there, and then accepted a job at UC Davis. Okay. And then at UC Davis, I met Uriah Faber. I attribute everything to him with me getting into the
great.
Sport. When I accepted a job at UC Davis, he coached along with me, and he was like, dude, you need to do mixed martial arts. He brought over Randy Couture, he brought over Brandon Vera.
Oh, wow.
And that's where I met Brandon Vera, was in Sacramento.
I see, so you guys have a history together.
We do.
Nice,
we do.
Nice.
And then he brought over who's who, like Quinn Rampage Jackson, Frank Trigg, James Irvin. And there was a host of other people that were just a who's who in mixed martial arts that just came over, and I got into it. My first sparring session was against Randy Couture.
Oh, wow.
And I was just like, I was hooked after that.
What you guys are doing with UFC, it's really become a mainstream sport, whereas before it was looked upon as sort of like a blood sport and kind of like cockfighting, I guess, if you will.
Yeah.
How do you feel being a part of that, seeing that now become so mainstream?
I think it's very cool just to see the rise of MMA. It's awesome from the roots when you said eye gouging and the bare fists.
And the makeup,
Yeah, you know, that stuff, you know. It's just from the professional wrestling to the real stuff,
right,
to where it is now, you know, just to see the evolution and how there's, you know, regulations as far as rules and stuff, and it's actually a sport now.
It's like a pure sport.
It's a pure sport now, you know, and just to see the rise and the popularity of it, you can't script it at all.
Okay, Mark, so what I'm dying to know is, what is more gratifying for you, either getting a guy to tap out or knocking him out?
Granted that I don't have any submissions on my record, I've knocked a lot of guys out, so that's what I look for.
Would you want somebody to tap out?
You know, I do, man, because a lot of people don't know about my ground game.
Yeah.
You know, and I have a very good ground game, and I've submitted, you know, black belts.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, the time will come. You know,
so. It's gratifying either way, though.
Yeah, that's right.
To win,
just getting a W, you know.
You're such a soft-spoken, like, friendly, really. I mean, you're such a nice guy.
Yeah.
When I see you in the octagon and when I'm talking to you, it's so different.
Yeah.
How do you get your mindset in there? What's going through your head to prep for a fight and to become that guy in the octagon?
You play many roles in your life, you know. Take, for example, a teacher. You teach in the classroom, you act a different way.
Right.
But when you're home with your friends, you act a different way. So when I step into the octagon, I'm just, you know, I'm there to do what I prepared for 3 months.
Right.
You know, and then afterwards, I'm back to the the way I am.
Being Mark.
Yeah, being Mark.
Can you imagine if you were the wrecking machine all the time?
Yeah, man.
That would be awful.
I wouldn't have any friends.
I know.
You know, you know, for me, it's about improving every time I step into the octagon, you know, and improving not only as a fighter, but, you know, also, too, I also want to improve on in my other roles that I play in my life, you know. So yeah. I'm a father, I'm a son, right. I'm a coach. I just don't want to improve on one aspect in my life.
Right, you want to be balanced.
Yeah, balanced.
Basically.
Yeah.
Speaking of other roles, you own a gym.
Mm-hmm.
What's it called?
It's called Rain Training Center.
How did that come about, and what do you plan to do with that?
I moved down to Southern California just so that I could, you know, help my family a little bit more. It took us probably about a year because we argued back and forth. I'm like, what are you talking about, man? We got a great situation.
Yeah.
She was like, for you. Not for me.
So you guys came to an agreement.
Yeah, we came to agreement.
Yeah.
And I said, you know what? I think it's time to move. And so we stepped out on faith, and we moved down south. And then that's where I met a bunch of my training partners now.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have the best training camp in the world.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, congratulations
on
that.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hard work on three. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Hard work!
What can we expect from you in the upcoming year?
Be expecting a lot, because for me, you're going to see a great stand-up game, you know,
yeah.
Because that's what I've lacked. And in 2011, I'm definitely going to improve as a stand-up fighter. And I've made leaps and bounds from my debut.
Yeah.
And now I'm very comfortable on my feet, and I see punches coming at me now, and I see kicks. And so it's a game changer.
You know,
when you start getting comfortable on your feet, it's a game changer. So, you know, I mean, it's going to be great.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right, now, maybe the most important question of the day, really, is can we get Ariane Celeste's phone number? So we can, no?
I'll let you,
My producer wants it, so you know.
I could probably introduce them.
Okay, yeah. You heard it rolling. We have one more piece of business to take care of. Me and you, we're gonna throw down on this mat. Are you ready?
If you haven't wrestled before, you're in a world of hurt. So,
oh, that was not very intimidating.
You're in a world of hurt.
Whatever.
It's like this. See this?
All right, Mark, now that I've made you tap out, my work here is done. Before I totally finish you off, do you want to tell everyone where we can find you?
Oh, you can find me at markmunoz.net. Markmunoz.net, baby.
Done. All right, Mark, well, thank you for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
It was a pleasure interviewing you, and now finishing you off. All right, guys, I'll catch you later. See you in the studio. Ready? You're going down. Tap out, buddy. Still waiting on that phone number, Mark. Ariane.
Yeah, call me first. Yeah, don't call her.
Call me.
Don't go anywhere, because after the break, April Chase will be getting Undiscovered. Stay tuned!
You guys, in this installment of Undiscovered, Joey gets the full lowdown from April Chase.
How about we take a small break and save us from the heartache?
All right, I'm here with the superstars. Please introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm Karina.
My name's Tim.
And we're from April Chase.
Came up with the name April Chase. I've been trying to figure out, what is April Chase?
So April Chase is kind of a deep meaning.
Okay, I'm getting ready for this.
Okay, okay.
Am I gonna cry?
You might. You might. April is the month of Aphrodite. She's a Greek goddess of love and beauty. And Chase means to follow or seek. So in a sense, April Chase means to follow or seek love.
Oh, all the girls are crying already.
I know. I know.
Yeah.
So how did the band come about?
Me and our drummer, we were in a band in high school. We knew we wanted a female front woman. I started playing guitar for one of these church bands, and Karina was playing bass, but she didn't want to sing in front of anybody. So we were at practice one day, and I heard her sing. I was like, okay, I'm stealing this girl.
So you stole her from church.
I stole her.
So you could steal in church. Describe your style of music you guys play.
We're definitely very heavily influenced by Paramore, My American Heart, but we definitely have our own twist to it. We're more and more finding our sound, like the longer we play together, and becoming more distinct.
We have an amazing sound, amazing look, and you know, just talking to you guys behind the scenes, your energy is incredible. I think you're young, I think you're gonna make it. When you make that million, remember, Cousin Joey.
We're just doing it for fun, you know? Like, we're all friends, we hang out, and whatever comes, will come.
And I just wanna say, I don't wanna play these games.
Here to perform their new song, Time Won't Tell.
Ladies and gentlemen, we give you April Chase. Mix Rated, but be sure to stay connected with us on Facebook, Twitter, and watch us on YouTube for full episodes in HD of Mix Rated.
And with season one coming to a close, be sure to tune into Mix Rated next week for our very special season finale.
Oh, the season finale already. All right, you guys, thank you so much for watching, and we're going to see you next week.
Thank you, y'all.
Bye-bye.